Hello friends, hope you're all doing great today. We'll start with an update regarding Eutelsat 10B launch today, the oldest rocket from SpaceX. A Eutelsat broadband communication satellite was launched into orbit on its final flight last night, with the goal of bringing internet access to ships and aircraft traveling through the North Atlantic, Europe, the Middle East, and Africa. Since early September, Eutelsat has conducted 4 significant satellite launches, and this mission is expected to wrap up the run. At 9:59 p.m. Eastern Standard Time Tuesday, 2:57 Greenwich Mean Time Wednesday, the Florida-based Cape Canaveral Space Force Station's Pad 40 saw the launch of the Eutelsat 10B satellite atop a Falcon 9 rocket. Previously, Monday night's launch attempt was scrubbed a few hours prior to liftoff. The Falcon 9 rocket's 229-foot, 70-meter first stage won't be recovered by SpaceX. According to a contract between the launch company and Eutelsat, the Falcon 9 was used for lifting the Eutelsat 10B satellite into orbit as high as it can go. As planned, no propellant will be saved for landing maneuvers on the first stage. According to the official forecast from the U.S. Space Force's 45th Weather Squadron, SpaceX decided to go ahead with the launch despite having only a 20% chance of favorable weather for the launch on Tuesday night. The launch of the satellite into a super synchronous transfer orbit will cut the time it takes for it to reach its final operational geostationary orbit by about 10 days, according to a spokesperson for Thales Alenia Space, the maker of Eutelsat 10B. Based on Thales SpaceBus NEO satellite platform, Eutelsat 10B will use plasma thrusters to circularize its orbit at geostationary altitude 22,000 miles over the equator, where it will circle the planet in perfect time with its rotation. According to a spokesperson for Thales, the total launch mass of Eutelsat 10B is approximately 5.5 metric tons, or 10,000 pounds, on Monday. The next year, Eutelsat 10B would enter geostationary orbit and direct itself to a working location 10 degrees east of the equator. The satellite will increase the capacity for internet connectivity services for ships and aircraft traveling over the heavily traveled North Atlantic corridor between Europe and North America. According to Eutelsat, the satellite's owner and operator based in Paris, Eutelsat 10B will also offer comparable services throughout Europe, the Mediterranean region, and the Middle East. 2 multi-beam, high-throughput Ku-band payloads are carried by Eutelsat 10B for use in maritime and aviation internet services. These 2 payloads each have 116 spot beams with a throughput of roughly 35 gigabits per second and the ability to process more than 50 gigahertz of bandwidth. Following the launch of the Eutelsat Connect VHTS satellite in September, on an Ariane 5 rocket, Eutelsat 10B is the 4th sizable communication satellite from Eutelsat to launch in the past 2.5 months. Following launches from Florida on Falcon 9 rocket in October, and earlier this month, Eutelsat's fleet now includes 2 Hotbird TV broadcasting satellites. Speaking of another significant launch, weather issues forced SpaceX to cancel Tuesday's NASA CRS-26 space station resupply mission. On Saturday, November 26th at 2:20 p.m. Eastern Time, the next launch attempt will take place with weather conditions expected to be 60% go. Let's take a look into another interesting update. The successful launch of the Artemis 1 mission comes at the perfect time for the European Space Agency as it seeks backing from its member states for new exploration missions. The Orion Spacecraft Service Module, which is responsible for power, propulsion, and other functions, was made by ESA. Since its launch, that service module has been operating efficiently in preparation for a crucial maneuver, the outbound powered flyby, which is to be performed by the service module's main engine early on November 21st. Philip DeLu, European Service Module Program Manager at ESA, during a pre-launch interview at the Kennedy Space Center, mentioned, "The propulsion system will be one of the subsystems that we will have a close eye on." The first of six European Service Modules, ESM, that ESA has currently agreed to supply will be installed on Artemis missions. Airbus Defense and Space is the prime contractor. ESM 3 and 4 are being built at an Airbus facility in Bremen, Germany, while ESM 2 was delivered to KSC last year. DeLu claimed that a number of advancements were made to the later service modules, each of which saw improvements. He further mentioned, "The efficiencies are much better. The team has gotten into a routine where they process things much faster, but there are still a number of things to resolve and to improve." ESM 4, which will be used on the Artemis 4 mission, brings about additional changes to the ESM. Orion will be able to launch co-manifested payloads like Lunar Gateway modules, thanks to the Space Launch System Block 1B rocket's improved performance, which will be the first to do so. DeLu claimed that among the modifications is a change in the angle of the reaction control system thrusters to account for the extra mass when Orion docks to those co-manifested payloads and prevent thruster plumes from striking the solar arrays on the service module. In order to keep up with the cadence of later Artemis missions, he claimed that ESA wants to start producing the service modules routinely with ESM 4 and eventually aim to produce one service module annually. "We're not there yet, but that is eventually the goal we'll reach starting with ESM 4 onwards," he added. In the interim, Orion successfully completed the outbound powered flyby burn at 7:44 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, accelerating the spacecraft to a speed of more than 580 miles per hour by firing the orbital maneuvering system engine for 2 minutes and 30 seconds. Orion was traveling at a speed of 5,023 miles per hour when it burned 320 miles above the moon. Orion sped past the moon at a distance of 81 miles while traveling at a speed of 5,102 miles per hour shortly after the burn. The European Space Module will be used by the spacecraft to undertake the far-off retrograde orbit insertion burn on Friday, November 25th. For the duration of nearly a week, Orion will stay in this orbit to test its systems. Before it returns to Earth, the far-off retrograde will have carried Orion 40,000 miles past the moon. On Monday, November 28th, at 3:05 p.m. Central Standard Time, Orion will be more than 268,500 miles away from Earth. On Friday, November 25th, at 3:53 p.m. CST, Orion will be more than 57,000 miles away from the moon. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comments section. This will help us to improve.